Let us begin our fourth lecture on surface potential and threshold based solutions of the drain to source current. First, we will summarize the key results of the previous lecture. In the previous lecture, we got a solution of the surface potential psi s as a function of gate to bulk voltage and channel voltage from y dimensional analysis. The steps were as follows. You integrate the y dimensional Poisson-Boltzmann relation to get EYS, that is the y directed surface electric field.
So, if I want to show you that this is your source and drain and this is your y direction, right. So, you are getting a field in the y direction, this is your depletion region, this is the so called inversion region, this is N plus and this is P.
Now, how do you get the EYS? So, you have dou square psi by dou y square, you integrate this equation once and we have discussed the steps of integration, I am not going to go through again. When you integrate it once, you get dou psi by dou y, in fact that is what is the electric field in the y direction. Then after you have got EYS, we have seen that right hand side of EYS is a square root term and therefore you have both plus and minus roots of EYS, out of which the plus or positive EYS is used for depletion and inversion because it is a p-type substrate, right, that we are considering, and the negative EYS is used for accumulation, right. So, when the EYS is in this direction, which is what it happens when you have a p-type substrate, EYS is positive. Now, we approximated the EYS by removing some terms considering the practical situations, and then using this approximated EYS, we use the equation QS equal to minus epsilon S EYS to get the following in inversion, right, and that is this QS as a function of psi s. After getting QS as a function of psi s, we substituted this into the surface potential equation or SPE with, and in this SPE we put psi aux equal to minus QS plus QF by C aux using the gradual channel approximation and so on, right. And then this surface potential equation with these substitutions led us to the surface potential equation that is given at the bottom of the slide. Now, in this equation here, the term psi s is equal to psi s naught, surface potential is psi s naught for V equal to Vsb. If you substitute Vsb here, you will get psi s naught, okay, all these terms will become psi s naught, and similarly if you substitute V equal to Vdb, you get psi sl or the surface potential at the drain. Now, the important point is this psi s expression saturates with increase in channel voltage V, causing saturation of IDS. So, this is the reason why the IDS saturates in our theory, because the surface potential psi s saturates. I gave it to you as an assignment to show that this expression for psi s saturates. I am sure you would have attempted it, right. Now, in case you had difficulty in appreciating how this particular expression leads to a saturating values of psi s, let me quickly give you some hint. So, this is psi s as a function of V. Now, you can see here that this entire term has a negative sign, right, this term has a negative sign. So, I can push this term to the left hand side, so that all the psi s dependent terms will be on the left hand side, then this will come as a positive term. So, now on the left hand side I will have psi s and this entire term, okay. Now, concentrate on this particular exponential. When your V is 0, this term is psi s minus twice phi f by Vt, okay. And let us say you get some value of psi s, evidently it will be non-zero, okay, because on the right hand side you have Vgb minus Vfb. So, let us put some non-zero value here for psi s. Now, as you increase your V, what is going to happen is this exponential term is going to go on decreasing, right? Why is it going to decrease? Because though Cs is also going to change, but since the V here appears against a negative sign, okay, this entire quantity will go on decreasing as you increase your V. So if this quantity decreases, your value of Cs will increase, because you can see that we have moved this to the left hand side, and if the exponential term is reduced, in other words, you have three terms on the left hand side dependent on psi s. If any one of the terms reduces, the value of psi s will increase, because right hand side is remaining the same, right? So it goes on increasing, so you get increase here. Now let us appreciate why it will saturate. You can see that if this term, right, if this exponential term, if the exponent becomes more and more negative, the exponential term falls, and you know exponential of a negative variable goes to 0 if the variable goes on increasing. So this term is going to vanish, this entire exponential term is going to vanish, and once that happens, right, you are left with an equation for psi s. So if I remove this term, your equation, you are left with a very simple equation for psi s. It is a quadratic, okay, and when you solve it, psi s will be a constant, because it will be a function of Vgb minus Vfb and gamma, all of which are constants. So therefore, for large V, it will reach a saturation, okay. And in fact, you also know what will be the saturation value. Saturation value is obtained by removing the exponential term and solving the remaining quadratic equation, okay. So now, let us put together, or rather in the previous lecture, we put together the surface potential based model as follows. So IDS consists of diffusion and drift. The diffusion current is given by this formula. The drift current is given by a somewhat longer formula, where you have the linear square law and 3 by 2 power law terms. The psi s is solved by using this equation, and to repeat, the above psi s expression saturates with increase in V. Hence, this model predicts the IDS behavior over the entire bias range without the need for any partitions such as sub or super threshold, non-saturation or saturation, and weak or strong inversion, okay. So see, it is a such a nice expression, right, it includes drift and diffusion and saturates naturally. You can carefully see here no threshold voltage term or no saturation voltage term has arisen, okay. So let us illustrate our result pictorially. You remember we had sketched this kind of the current voltage curve, okay, on a semi-log plot. Note that here current is on a log plot, whereas the VDS is on a semi-log, VDS is on a linear scale, right. The ID is on a log scale, while the VDS is on a linear scale, okay. Now what we have done is, we have struck out some terms such as threshold voltage and this line which partitions between saturation and non-saturation, right. And we are striking out this also, because this current is because of leakage, and we have not modeled leakage in our model, okay. So the surface potential based model predicts this entire variation of the current without introducing any threshold voltage or this partition, though of course it does not model the leakage current. So that is why we are striking it off, and therefore if you use a surface potential based model and make a calculation, you will get all these curves, okay, smooth, and you will get all these curves in a smooth manner, right, okay. Let us see what kind of curves would the surface potential based model give when you plot ID as a function of VGS, okay. So here two types of plots are shown. This is the plot which uses the current on the right hand side, right, that is why this arrow is shown here, and this is a log scale. So this current versus voltage is on a semi log plot, whereas this blue curve uses the current scale which is on the left hand side, that is why this arrow is shown here, and this is linear scale. So this is linear linear plot, okay, the voltage is always on a linear scale. So we are plotting ID as a function of VGS, keeping VDS and VBS constant, right. Now this thing is struck off. In other words, there is no threshold voltage concept. So you will not have any partition like this in the surface potential based model. That is why this is struck off. And this part is because of leakage, which we are not able to model. So the surface potential based model would give us these curves smoothly, okay. So let us return to our previous slide, giving all the expressions of the surface potential based model. And let us make another important point. This is about the channel length L. L denotes that part of the source to drain channel over which gradual channel approximation is valid. Remaining part of the channel delta L near the drain accommodates the potential variation from psi s L to psi naught plus VDB, okay. Now let us understand this part about interpretation of channel length and the so called channel length modulation, okay. So let me sketch a diagram to illustrate this point. So this is your MOSFET. This is your gate. This is your depletion layer. This is your inversion layer, and this is the so called region, right. Here at this end, so the edge of the channel comes only up to this point when your VDS goes on increasing, right. Beyond a value that I am going to tell you shortly. So this distance here, I am sorry, not this, this distance is delta L. So the channel length L is up to this point. Now let us give the characteristics of this point. This is the inversion layer. So this is grounded. Here you are applying VDB, you are applying BGB here, and you are applying VSB there. This is a P-type substrate. Okay, so let me sketch below this the potential variation. So I am plotting the surface potential along this, okay. So this is your x along this axis. So at the source here, the surface potential, that is the potential drop like this, right, in the depletion layer. This is psi is 0 on a other, and on the other hand here, this is the so called psi s L at this point, okay. And you are going on increasing VDB, but the psi s L has saturated, right. So we talked about it, as you increase V, the channel voltage V, the psi s saturates. So at the drain it will saturate at psi s L, but you are going on increasing VDB. Now what is the potential at this point, okay. So if I put the potential here at this point, at this edge, this is psi naught plus VDB, okay, where psi naught is a built-in potential of the p-n junction, right. So that is somewhat like the potential drop across a reverse bias n plus p junction. When you apply voltage VDB, the total potential drop here is psi naught plus VDB. So now the difference between psi naught plus VDB
that is at this point, and the psi s l which is the potential here at this point, that difference falls across delta l. So let us show this in this graph. So this potential goes on increasing and it is something like this, okay. So this value is psi s 0, what we are plotting is psi s, so this axis is psi s, and when you come here it becomes psi s l, and when you reach the drain it becomes psi naught plus VDB. So when you start from VDB equal to VSB, your potential psi s l will follow VDB as you increase VDB, but beyond some point, so let me sketch that part. If I sketch psi s l versus VDB, you will get something like this, right. So this is the saturation value of psi s l, because that is the nature of the psi s versus VDB function. So this is the saturation value of psi s. So when you are increasing VDB up to this point, psi s l is following your VDB, but beyond this point it is saturating, but you are going on increasing VDB. So the difference between the potential at the drain contact and the potential at this point, which is the edge of the channel length L, okay, that difference falls across delta L. So delta L will go on increasing from 0 as you increase your VDB, right. And this psi naught plus VDB minus psi s l, that is this potential difference, it will fall across delta L. So this edge of the channel will go on moving towards the source. So this is the channel length modulation, this is the interpretation of channel length, okay. So over this L, your garage channel approximation will be valid, but over this delta L, it will be invalid. Now let us move on further. Again we come back to the slide of the various expressions. What about the average mobility? Let us focus on that, okay. We are using this average mobility expression here, or average mobility term. For the diffusion current, this average surface mobility for electrons is approximately equal to mu n effective given by mu n 0 by 1 plus E y effective by E naught power n, okay. So you see that here there is no longitudinal field effect that we need to consider, we only need to consider the vertical field, okay, because we are in the diffusion regime, okay. And if you recall, in the diffusion regime across the channel the voltage does not fall much. So let me recall that, while for drift current you have your depletion region varying like this, okay, where it is less at the source and more at the drain. But when you are talking about diffusion, it will be constant until the drain, though the depletion region between the drain and bulk, this will be large, but the depletion region in the channel, it will be uniform, okay. So that is a condition in the subthreshold region. Please recall, there will be an inversion charge which is very weak, so subthreshold is weak inversion region, it will vary from source to drain, no doubt, but this will be very less compared to the depletion charge. So that is why we are not considering the effect of this field, because this field from drain to source along x, this field is very small, you only need to consider the vertical field. So that is why we are considering the mu n effective.
Now here when you try to evaluate this, now you recall that mu n 0 is the bulk value of mobility corresponding to the particular doping in the substrate. When you evaluate this, where E y effective is the effective electric field in the y direction and E naught is a critical field, the E y effective is written in terms of qb plus 0.5 qi by epsilon s with the modulus, because E y is positive, right, whereas the charges are negative here, inversion charge and depletion charge are negative. Now in this expression in sub threshold, qi is much less than qb. So just now we have remarked that because qi is much less than qb, even though qi varies, qb does not change, it is uniform. So that being the case, since qi is much less than qb, we can remove qi term here and we can write the ey effective in terms of qb alone. So that would be your expression for average surface mobility here. How do you find out qb? Well, you know how you can find out qb in terms of the surface potential, okay, using p-n junction theory. So we can further write this qb in terms of the surface potential as gamma into c aux into square root of psi s naught. You can write qb as this numerator term, okay. So this is what I said you can do in terms of p-n junction theory. Psi s naught is the surface potential at the source. Now you will say, but what is happening surface potential at the drain? So I want to take you back again to this diagram, and we have said that from source to drain here the channel depletion layer is same, so the surface potential does not change much in weak inversion, okay. So you can take it to be equal to the value at the source. Now let us look at the drift current. What is the average surface mobility for drift current? Now the average surface mobility for drift current, you will recall the expression that we had written, it is 1 by L into 0 to L into this term, right, where the mu n effective is given by this formula, and of course the E y effective we had written in the previous, so both these expressions we had written in the previous slide, right. The new thing is only this. So let us try to understand this particular expression, right. So what is that expression really, okay. So you will recall we defined, let me write here on the side, mu n s average as 1 by L integral 0 to L dx by mu n s. Okay, where now what is mu n s? So mu n s is equal to the mu n effective, which includes effect of the vertical electric field, divided by a term which includes the effect of the horizontal electric field, that is 1 plus exs. I am putting a modulus because ex is from drain to source, whereas x axis is from source to drain, by V sat by mu n effective, okay. So that is a so called critical electric field, and here this term is raised to beta and the whole thing is raised to 1 by beta, okay. This is the so called critical this thing. Again I will draw the axis for your convenience. This is x, this is y, this is p type substrate, okay. Now it is this formula which is written here, okay. Now just understand this, how do you get this? So this minus 1 here is this minus 1, okay. And this mu n s is this. So since there is, this is 1 by mu n s, your denominator here will go up and numerator will come down. So let us write 1 by mu n s. This will be equal to 1 plus this whole quantity to the power beta to the power 1 by beta upon mu n effective. Now I take this mu n effective inside. So when I take it inside, since there is a power 1 by b, mu n effective will get raised to the power beta, okay, but with a negative sign because mu n effective is in the denominator, right. So mu n effective raised to the power minus beta. So that is what is happening here when I take it inside. Similarly, when I take this mu n effective inside, this term here, it will cancel with this mu n effective term, okay, and therefore you will be left with Vsat alone, okay. So that is how you get this EXS by Vsat whole power beta. So now you understand how we have got this expression here. Now let us look at how do we integrate this. So to integrate, we have to make some approximations. Beta is equal to 1, because otherwise analytical integration of this equation is not possible. And what about mu n effective? It actually varies in the x direction from source to drain. However, we will assume mu n effective to be constant with x at its value mu n effective 0 at the source, okay. So these are the two approximations we are going to do. So we will set this beta as 1. So okay, this beta will set it equal to 1, and this mu n effective, though it varies from source to drain according to this formula here, where EY effective is given by this formula, we are going to use its value at the source. That means we are going to use this here, we will put a 0 here and we will put a 0 here, right, that is what we are going to do. So this will now be a constant when I am integrating with respect to x. So when I do that, I will get this mobility expression, okay. Mu n s bar, average mu n s, is given by 1 by mu n effective 0 plus BDS by L divided by Vsat, okay, where mu n effective 0 and EY effective 0 are given here. Now let us look at this a little bit. How do I get BDS by L in the numerator? So let us go back to this slide. So what is happening is this EXS, okay, is being written as VDS by L. How does that happen? So since these two terms are being summed up when I put beta equal to 1, okay, this whole power, this bracket power 1 by beta becomes just 1 here, okay. So this goes off, you are really just summing up two terms, okay, and integrating them. So let us consider this integration individually. So you are getting integral 0 to L mod EXS by Vsat, the power beta is again power 1, so there is no beta, dx, right. Now Vsat is a constant. Now EXS, consider your MOS device, EXS the field at the surface in the x direction, this is EXS. When I integrate this in dx, so this is your x direction, from source, that is x is equal to 0, to drain, x is equal to L, this is 0, this is L, then what will I get? I will get the difference in potential between this point and this point, right. And what is the difference in potential between these points? I can either talk in terms of surface potential or in terms of applied voltage. If I talk in terms of surface potential, here the potential is psi SL and here the potential is psi S naught. So really when I integrate EXS from source to drain, I will get psi sl minus psi s naught. Now, when I substitute psi sl as, so let me create some space. So, I substitute psi sl in terms of VDB and psi s naught in terms of VSB. So, this quantity will be VDB plus phi naught, and this quantity will be VSB plus phi naught. Okay, phi naught is twice phi f plus 6 VT here. So, this phi naught cancels when you take this subtraction. So, it becomes VDB minus VSB, and VDB minus VSB is nothing but VDS. So, that is how the integral of EXS over DX becomes VDS. Okay, and there is this 1 by L here outside, so that you take inside, so it, this becomes VDS by L. So, that is how you are getting this VDS by L. Now, why are you not getting the L division here for mu ineffective? Because this has become a constant after you have made it mu ineffective 0, okay, and you are integrating that with respect to dx from 0 to L. So, you get an L out of this integration in the numerator that cancels with the L in the denominator. So, that is how you get this equation. Okay. Now, mu ineffective 0 is this formula. This is straightforward, we know this. The Ey effective 0, you have to determine Qi and Qb at the source. So, that is why you are going to use the expression for Qi in terms of psi s and put psi s equal to psi s naught, and you are going to use expression for Qb and you are going to put psi s equal to psi s naught in that expression. Now, the expressions for Qi and Qb in terms of psi s are given here. So, Qi as a function of psi is given by minus C aux into VGB minus VFB minus psi s minus gamma into square root psi s, while Qb as a function of psi is given by minus gamma into C aux into square root of psi s. So, you substitute psi s 0 for psi s. So, you make this 0 here. That is what you are supposed to do. And how do you solve for psi s naught and psi sl? So, well, that we solve using this equation, okay, by substituting V equal to VSB here, you get psi s naught. Substitute V equal to VDB here, you will get psi sl. Okay. So, that is how you can get this average mobility. So, you can see that the computational procedure is a little involved, right? It is a nice model. It predicts current voltage variation smoothly over entire region of operation, okay, but there are a lot of computation involved. So, that is why people have gone in for some simplification, right, and other types of models. So, further simplification of this average mobility expression. So, you are writing the denominator here V sat as, there is an L coming here, okay. So, you are writing this V sat in terms of a critical electric field, right, and you are moving this mu n effective out. Please look at this. So, let us show how that happens. So, you take this mu n effective out. So, you will get, since there is a reciprocal there, so mu n effective 0 into this you have taken out. So, you get 1 plus VDS upon L, and this mu n effective goes up when you put it here. So, mu n effective 0 by V sat, or I can put this mu n effective in the denominator and write it as V sat by mu n effective 0. Now, this term V sat by mu n effective 0, you can clearly see that it has units of electric field, and this is actually the critical electric field. So, this bracketed term is EC. You can check this, that this has units of critical electric field. From we have discussed this mobility expression in one of our earlier modules. Otherwise, you see dimensionally that it has electric field dimensions. V sat is centimeter per second and mu n effective is centimeter square per volt second. So, second cancels, 1 centimeter goes in denominator, you are getting volt per centimeter, right? That is electric field. That is how here you get the critical electric field. Of course, there is a power minus 1 over there. So, in other words, this term comes in the denominator. So, that is what is actually shown here, okay, where EC is V sat by mu n effective 0. So, let us once again summarize our surface potential based model in the form of a plot and then use this plot for the surface potential based model to show how we are getting into the threshold based model, okay. So, this shows IDS as a function of VGB on a semi-log plot. IDS is on a log scale here. Let us show the segments from which this behavior is obtained. So, you have the diffusion component given by this expression, and if you plot that, this part of the curve, which is approximately a straight line, okay, is actually because of diffusion, is because of this expression. However, when you increase your VGB, as you get into the strong inversion region, your current because of diffusion goes on increasing, but at a slower rate than the total current because of drift and diffusion, right. So, this is the diffusion component. Now, let us put the drift component. So, in strong inversion, your drift component dominates over diffusion component. The drift component is given by this formula. However, for lower values of VGB, your diffusion dominates over drift, okay. That is the way the picture is, and there is some region here where both are comparable. This is really the difficult region to model in very simple expressions, right. Now, in the background of this, let us introduce the threshold based model, okay. So, the first step in the threshold based model is to partition these smooth curve, okay, the smooth blue curve into three regions. Now, the partitioning voltages are the threshold voltage with respect to bulk, okay. The dash here indicates that this threshold voltage is calculated using the twice phi f criterion, okay. So, we have seen that there are two threshold voltages. One is the threshold voltage calculated based on the twice phi f criterion as we have done in the first level course, and other is the threshold voltage that you get by linear extrapolation of the current voltage curve. So, theoretically if you want to calculate this, that is the VTB that is obtained by assuming the surface potential to be twice phi f plus 6 VT. So, V dash TB is the threshold voltage calculated using the twice phi f criterion, while VTB is the threshold voltage calculated using the twice phi f plus 6 VT criterion, okay. So, below V dash TB on the VGB axis you have weak inversion. Between V dash TB and VHB you have the moderate inversion, and beyond VHB you have strong inversion. So, you are partitioning this curve, this blue curve, smooth curve, into three regimes: weak inversion, moderate and strong inversion. And what you find here is in weak inversion the blue curve on a semi-log plot is almost a straight line, and we can show that similarly the red curve the blue curve in the strong inversion region, okay, is a square law, has a square law behavior, okay. So, let us show this explicitly. The dashed lines show the exponential approximation for diffusion. Now, we have not shown how you get a simple exponential expression, okay. We are right now telling you the outline, how it is going to be. So, it will turn out. Now, why is it exponential? Well, that is very simple. On a semi-log plot, if a curve is straight line, you know it has to be a power law, okay, and exponential is a form of power law. So we will show that the diffusion component in the surface potential expression will reduce to a simple exponential after some approximations, okay. So that is this dashed line. On the other hand, this other dashed line here shows the square law approximation, and we will show that the drift part of the surface potential based model will lead us to this simple square law expression after some approximations. Now notice here that if we were to use the exponential approximation for diffusion, even in moderate inversion, you will get very high currents, much higher than the actual current. On the other hand, if you use a square law approximation, okay, which is valid for drift current, in the moderate inversion, you will get much lower currents than the actual current. Okay. So that is why this moderate inversion region is really very difficult to model. We will be able to model using simple expressions the weak inversion and the strong inversion, using exponential approximation in weak inversion and square law approximation for strong inversion. And then later on we will discuss how to stitch together the square law and exponential approximations so that you get a smooth variation here without adding any separate expression for the moderate inversion region. Now, with that introduction of the threshold based model, let us summarize what we have achieved in this lecture. So we achieved a number of things. So in this lecture, we first summarized all the expressions of the surface potential based model, and then we gave an interpretation of the channel length. We said that when you go on increasing the drain voltage from value equal to the source voltage, your surface potential at the drain psi s l follows the drain voltage up to a point, but beyond some drain to bulb voltage the surface potential saturates naturally, right, as a behavior of that surface potential expression. So therefore, the excess potential between the drain contact and the saturation value of psi s l falls across a channel length modulation portion delta l, right. Quickly, this is the diagram which shows you that. So this is your inversion region, this is delta l, this is l. This is the so called psi s l sat, and here you are applying VDB. So at this end your potential drop is psi naught plus VDB. So this difference between psi naught plus VDB and psi s l sat falls across delta l. So this is another important point made we made in this lecture. Then we also discussed the average surface mobility, right. What is the expression for the average surface mobility, how to calculate it for the diffusion component of the current and for the drift component of the current. So we found in the diffusion component of the current, the mobility does not depend on the drain to source voltage, while in drift component of the current, the mobility does depend on the drain to source voltage, right. It also depends on, of course, gate to source voltage, because both diffusion and drift mobilities are a function of the vertical field, which is always strong. So in fact, without the vertical field in a MOSFET, here vertical field is this, you cannot really get any inversion layer, right, whether it is diffusion or whether it is weak inversion or strong inversion. And finally, we showed how when you plot the surface potential based model, drain current as a function of the gate to bulk voltage on a semi-log plot, you get a linear segment for the weak inversion, right, on a semi-log plot. So this linear segment on the semi-log plot amounts to an exponential kind of behavior, and in the strong inversion region, the behaviors obtained from the surface potential based model can shown to be square law. We have not shown it. We said it can be shown, and we are going to show it in the next lecture. The moderate inversion region is a region which is difficult to model. So in weak inversion, diffusion current dominates over drift current. In strong inversion, drift current dominates over diffusion. Moderate inversion, both currents are comparable. We mentioned that the exponential segment of the weak inversion and the square law segment of the strong inversion can be stitched together in a way in which you get a smooth transition from the weak to strong inversion in the moderate inversion region. So, how to do that, we will see in subsequent lectures.